I would like to demonstrate the proper way to do a thrip cloth check method, more popularly known as shmata bedika. The items necessary are a light box and a 60 micron piece of mesh, which is why it's called the shmata bedika, and a basin of water. Take the basin of water, add some dishwashing liquid to the water. Now use soap for a dishwasher, which does not cause any bubbles. The water should be slippery. Take the produce, agitate it in the water for approximately 10 seconds. Shake off the produce. Then, technically speaking, you can check the water over a light box in the basin like this. However, the shmata method is actually more effective and much easier. It's helpful to have two strainers to sandwich the thrip cloth in between. You take the water. Pour it through the shmata. Then you take the shmata and put it on the light box. And then you check the shmata over the light box.
Hello and welcome to Starkey's webinar, special webinar this month. We're here in the Starkey offices in Baltimore, Maryland. To my right is Rabbi Shalom Tendler. Welcome, Rabbi Tendler, again.
Thank you, Rabbi Goldberg.
My name is Rabbi Tzvi Goldberg, and we are pleased to present this special edition of our monthly webinar. This webinar is held every month, the last Wednesday of the month. The normal web address is learntorah.clickwebinar.com/kosher, but we're here on a special edition, so we have a Torah web address, torah.clickwebinar.com/bugs. We welcome you to join us every month. If you'd like to join us by phone, normally that will be a good way of joining in, but for this particular webinar where we have things we want to show you, it won't be as effective, but we'll give you the number anyway, 218-895-1203. That's 218-895-1203, passcode 2020. We are going to show you videos and pictures of insects, and we're going to discuss how to check your vegetables and your fruits for the insects. A lot of the work that we're going to show you was done by Reb Zev Steen, so we're very grateful to him for his input and his dedication. We have chat. If you have a question, please do chat with us and we'll try to get to it, although we will be taking questions only at specific times to give Rabbi Tendler some time to get across the information. We think that after all is said and done, most of the questions will be answered at some point. So we're going to take the questions at specified points. The chat is moderated by Ellie Reidler. So if you don't see your chat comment right away, just give it a little bit of time. Some are saying that we hear you, and some are saying no sound coming through. So I'll let Reb Ellie deal with that issue. And without further ado, we'd like to begin our webinar. And Rabbi Tendler, that's a nice introductory picture there.
All right, so that is actually a picture of somebody who's not a mashgiach currently for the Star K. he applied for the job, but we didn't think his eyesight was good enough, so we
didn't hire. Why does he need a magnifying glass?
So we'll talk about that, actually. Apparently he feels he needs one in order to be able to check for insects, which is probably one of the reasons why we're not hiring him.
Okay.
But anyways, having said that, let's get started into our topic over here. So as Kohelet says, Ein Chodesh Tachas HaShemesh. So the question is, why all of a sudden is there so much hype about all these insects over the last number of years? You know, growing up, we didn't eat that much salad anyway, but I shouldn't say that. But, you know, this whole industry, so to speak, of checking vegetables for insects is something that's only developed over the last number of years. And it is definitely true that in previous generations, they did not necessarily have the same issues that we have today. You know, Chazal and Paiskim are full of talk about different types of insect infestation issues over various times. But infestation does change from time to time, from country to country, from region to region, and we'll talk more about that, those details a little bit later. But these days, right now in America, we know what the issues are, and what we're going to talk about today is hopefully addressing them. So a major reason why the issues today are more prevalent than they were in previous years is, for the reason you see on the screen now, is obviously everyone's becoming more and more healthy, which is definitely a good thing. You know, there's the green movement, where everyone's supposed to be eating more healthy, eating more salads. Green movement in the sense of the environmentalists, people who try to are anti-pesticides, which is not necessarily a bad thing either. The problem is by doing so, we have an increase in infestation of various fruits and vegetables.
I see you have integrated pest management.
Right, so that is actually IPM, integrated pest management, is a program, a federally mandated program, which farmers are not required to use, but any company with any, you know, normal quality control programs will only use the FDA program of IPM, which basically limits the amount of pesticides they can use under various circumstances. Which, you know, putting all this information together is basically why the infestation issue is now a much newer and a bigger issue than ever has been in the past, and it's something that we definitely have to deal with. At the same time, I'll just mention that you know, the government is not necessarily our friend. Now, nobody wants to eat insects. You know, whether even non-Jews, no one wants to eat insects. The problem is, as the good old saying goes, if you can't see it, it can't hurt you.
I think the non-Jewish world is surprised when they, if you show them that there is...
Yeah, they're very surprised. Now, anytime I visit lettuce companies and we go to the quality control lab and do our checking there, so we show the quality control people what we find in the items that they have already passed and are ready to sell, and usually they're pretty grossed out, to put it quite frankly. Again, you know, these bugs are very good at hiding, so... You know, if they don't see them, they don't care. But even from the a legal perspective, from the USDA perspective, the FDA perspective, they have certain guidelines of what they consider to be unhealthy. A classic example, which I always like to give, and these guidelines are published online. You can look online. The USDA has a published, they call it a food defect guide, which basically lists all the possible defects in different types of food, what is considered, at what level will it be considered unhealthy where they can possibly step in, you know, and have some, and do some, you know, government intervention. So for fruit, the example, it's full of examples like this, and, you know, don't look at this before you eat your dinner, this guide. One example.
Well, for those who are joining us in Israel, it might be about dinner time. So
right. So don't look at it yet online. If in frozen broccoli, for example, in 100 grams of frozen broccoli, they allow up to 60 aphids per 100 grams of frozen broccoli.
Okay, an aphid is a type of insect that we're going to show
right.
you.
We'll
what
show
it
you
looks
pictures
like.
Of what
right.
an aphid looks like. It's a type of insect you don't want to eat it. Not just because Rabban Shlom says not to, but even if you know, it's definitely not something that looks very appetizing. So just for those of us who don't use the metric system here in the United States, I don't know how many of you are from all over the rest of the world, so 100 grams of frozen broccoli for us in the United States, a 32-ounce bag of frozen broccoli, which is somewhat typical, is about 900 grams. So you could do the math and figure out for yourself what the government allowance is, and you could probably try also figure out what halacha would say about such a thing. So we definitely have to come up with our own procedures, and we can't really rely on the government intervention or government protocols to make our food and our produce, you know, acceptable to be eaten. So in halacha, though, that's as far as the government's concerned. Now let's talk about what the Torah says. The Torah has three levels when we talk about infestation, and this, you know, three levels in many different issues. But let's talk about we're talking about infestation. The first level is called muhsuk, which means something that most of the time is infested.
More than 50%.
More than 50% of servings of lettuce are infested. So if I would have 10 servings of lettuce in front of me, and I find a bug in about 5 or 6 of them, so that would be considered muhsuk b'tayloim. Now, an example of that is organic produce. Generally, organic produce is considered to be on that level of infestation because organic
has less.
It's hard to say organic has no pesticides, but it definitely has a lot less pesticides and is definitely much more highly infested than any other type of produce. We generally don't recommend using organic produce. I know that might sound strange to any, especially to people who are more health conscious. It's not that we don't have anything against organic per se, it's just very simply, actually we have a lot to do with organic, as you know, I'm sure it's been spoken about, you know. But we deal a lot with the organic industry. But organic produce is definitely much more, you know, has a lot more insect issues and is definitely harder to check. Now, again, if you know how to check, you can check organic produce also, but you'll probably have a harder time, and therefore we try to, it's definitely at least places under our hashgacha, we generally avoid organic produce.
When you're talking about organic produce that is prone to bugs.
Prone to bugs,
like
that's
if you
correct.
Had organic celery,
right.
That wouldn't...
Well, the celery might be an issue, but let's talk about organic apples, organic tomatoes, organic
right.
apples, things
right.
that don't have a bug issue, which we'll talk later
yeah,
about
that,
which items
okay.
have issues, which items don't have issues.
Right.
We'll actually talk in a few minutes. So items obviously don't have bug issues, we have no problem with organic produce, but only the items that have insect issues, organic produce is definitely more prone to infestation, and you know, you'll definitely have a harder time dealing with it. So that's as far as Muchsuk B'Teilorim is concerned. The second level is called Mir HaMotzi, which means it's mir, means less than 50%, but it's still Motzi, it's still found, you can still find you know, insects in these issues, in these types of produce. An example of that is most of our conventional greens, you know, the romaine lettuce, the iceberg, the cabbages, you know, the herbs in general. These are all items that are considered to be HaMotzi. So the exact levels, percentage of infestation in these items classically is defined as anywhere between 10 and 50%. Anything above 10% up to 50% is in the level of Mir HaMotzi. Now the difference between Muchsuk and Mir HaMotzi is significant. Something that's Muchsuk, Midaraisa, you have to check it before you eat it. It's a biblically mandated
requirement
that you have to check that item before you eat it. Something that's Mir HaMotzi is only Midarabbanan. The rabbis required you to check it. And there's a lot of differences that we're not necessarily going to have time to get into exact differences between the Derais and the Rabbanan, but it's very important to note this difference. The third level is what's called Mir She'eino Motzi, which is generally something, anything that's below 10%.
So there you get your questions about the cucumber with,
right,
with a bug.
Right, exactly.
So unlikely.
So Mir HaMotzi doesn't necessarily mean that you'll never
find...
Mir She'eino Motzi. I'm sorry, I think
right.
you're right over. Mir She'eino Motzi doesn't necessarily mean you'll never find in these items, but it means it's below the level that the Chacham, the Rabbanan, did not require you to check. So it could be you'll find, but doesn't necessarily mean that now you're a requirement to check. We get calls all the time. People find, you know, in all types of things. They find in cucumbers, they'll find
mm-hmm.
in a tomato, they'll find in a pepper. So it can happen. You can have a bad batch, definitely can happen, but doesn't necessarily mean that now you have to start checking these items. So examples of items that are considered Mir She'eino Motzi, and again, the way we develop these procedures, which we'll talk as we go through a little bit more about, is, you know, through research literally from the ground up. We have mashkichim, including myself, we go to the lettuce fields, we study how the lettuce is grown, how they're sprayed with pesticides, the whole process through washing and through checking and everything, and we really, you know, develop these procedures to see what works and what doesn't work.
I should say, let me add, that the Rebbe Tendler spends a lot of his time, when he's not busy with all the other things, going to the facilities in California, right?
Mostly California,
mostly
Arizona,
California.
Florida.
Right, okay.
All the places we like to go this time of year, yeah.
So you have a good idea of what's going on there. So this list includes beans, cherries, corn, flour, mango, nuts, onions, peppers, snap peas, spices, string beans, and tomatoes. The beans, sometimes we do recommend to check, right?
Sometimes, depending on the season, you know, we'll talk more a little later about barley and different items that, you know, could be subject to have infestation issues if they're not stored properly, which is generally the issue. But we'll talk more about that in a few minutes. Now, it's very important to understand there's many variables that can affect infestation in different items. You know, there's a whole list I put on the screen now. There's the location, there's the variety, there's the temperature, the wind, rain, altitude, roadways, railroad tracks, wires, proximity to organic or untreated or undertreated fields. And that sounds like a very long list, I understand, but you know, it really is that complicated.
What does the railroad tracks have to do with it?
So let me talk a few minutes about what these items are. So first of all, for the location and the variety, actually, I'll show you a picture about the location of the variety in a minute. But the temperature, all these items can affect, you know, whether there are going to be more insects or less insects. To answer Ray Goldberg's question as far as railroad tracks and wires, it's because when you have railroad tracks that are right next to the field, so there's generally a lot of dirt surrounding railroad tracks, and when the train, including a field that I was actually in just 2 weeks ago, and I actually saw this firsthand, when train comes through, right, the train doesn't exactly, besides a lot of noise, it also spreads a lot of dirt and dust blowing up around the train, and insects or flies or whatever else is in that dirt, it gets blown right onto the field. So even if they spray the field properly, you know, they treat the field properly to keep the insects away, as soon as that train comes through, it blows a whole new batch of dirt onto the field. The same thing with proximity to roadways. You know, it has the same issue. And wires is actually a very interesting item, and that is, I was in a field once in Salinas, California, with one of our growers, and And I got like to the middle of the field, which generally you would think would be, you know, the most clean, which is generally how it is. The edges of the field usually have more insects and the middle of the field have less. All of a sudden, in the middle of the field, all of a sudden I'm starting to find tons and tons of insects in the vegetables. And so I was asking the grower, like, why would this be? So we look up and we see there's wires going across the field.
Power lines.
So we explained that there are two ways that they spray the fields with insecticides. One is through tractor-based, which many of the people use, and the other one is through airplanes. Because airplanes or helicopters or things like that. So when there are wires that are going right through the field, if they use an air-based applicator, so the airplane can't spray that part of the field too well because he has to avoid the wires, and therefore in those parts of the fields you end up having more infestation. Now it's interesting because sometimes they try to fly under the wires, and you know the grower looked at me with a smile and he said, you know, sometimes they make it, and he said, and sometimes they don't. You know, there's usually every year a few accidents from pilots who try to pretend like they're in Hollywood and get under the wires with their airplanes, and you know they end up, you know, causing usually. There's definitely no bugs in that lettuce, but you know it's not really lettuce that you can eat after they're finished crashing into the field either. So the last thing is proximity to organic or undertreated fields, and that has to do obviously with even if you take care of your field and you spray it properly, water it properly, take care that all the weeds are gone. But if it's sitting right next to a field that is organic or has not been sprayed properly, so a lot of times if you have the insects from that field, you know, it can come over to the field, even the conventional field.
They transfer over.
They can fly. Now, they are bad flyers, which is why most of the insects are bad flyers, particularly thrips, and that's why wind also makes a big difference. So if it's very windy one day, you can have a lot less insects potentially in a field than if it would be less windy.
Let me just interrupt for a second, Rabbi Tendler. We have a lot of people asking questions, and I encourage you to keep chatting with us. At some point, we'll stop and we'll take your questions. I just want to give Rabbi Tendler a chance to say at least a portion of what you have presented. So keep going.
Again, talking about how different variables affect infestation, most of our lettuce, it comes from various different regions. It comes from Salinas most of the year, it comes from Yuma, Arizona, it comes from Florida, depending, right now a lot of it's coming from Florida on the East Coast. But most of it throughout the rest of the year, spring, summer especially, comes from Salinas, California, which a map of which I just put on the screen. Now Salinas, California, it usually stretches from Salinas to Soledad, that whole region that's circled over there. Now there's a very interesting thing about this region, and that it's something called microclimates, which it's very mountainous over there, it's hilly, and it's pretty close to the coast of the Pacific Ocean. And it's something that I personally experienced myself. The temperature there can change dramatically in a very, very short amount of time and within a very short distance. So you can drive from Salinas to Soledad, or let's say when I flew into San Francisco and you drive down, you know, as soon as you enter the region, the temperature can change 30 degrees in as you're driving, literally. So that really, really changes the picture on a lot of items. You know, you have a field that, you know, the best temperature to grow lettuce on is, let's say, about 70 degrees where it's cool, it's dry. You know, all of a sudden, you have a warm spell and the aphids come out as if they are coming out of nowhere. They come out of the woodwork and it really, really can affect things.
So where we're going with this is that there are different fields have different levels of infestation.
Right. Every field is going to be different, and there's really two points to this. And that is that it's very hard to gauge. If you go to the store and you buy a couple heads of Roman lettuce, or, you know, it's very hard to gauge, you know, and decide based on that whether Roman lettuce is an example, but how you decide when something is motzi or eno motzi. Because there are worse fields and there are better fields. And this is a constant, constant thing that it happens. Every head of lettuce could be different that you find in the store. So how do you decide when something's finally motzi? So the truth is that the percentages that we gave before are somewhat trivial because it's very hard to pinpoint unless you have a real, real, you know, specific study involved, or you have, you know, some uniform aspects to what the items you're looking at. So really what we do is, when we talk about Mina Motzi, the way Rav Osner says it, and other places can say it, is that Mishnah Yaakov himself says it also, is that you look at items that generally are infested. You're not surprised, the way Rav Osner's law, you're not surprised to find insects in these items. So the second point on that is moving, it, this, you know, segues into the second point, is that you know, sometimes even items that are Eino Matzui, you know, a lot of them are subject to the same growing conditions, and you'll have bad batches that come up. It doesn't necessarily mean, again, that something is Eino Matzui, but you can see very easily from understanding a little bit of how microclimates work and how vegetables are grown in the fields, the natural environment that they grow in, you know, things, you know, you can get peppers, let's say, that can come with an infestation issue. But it doesn't necessarily mean that all of a sudden peppers now are infested. You could have had some weird thing that happened with the weather. Right. You know, it can happen. But it doesn't necessarily mean that now these items are going to be matzui. This sign, actually, is right off U.S. Highway 101. Those of you who are familiar with California, it's a major highway. It goes right through Salinas, right through lettuce country. It says, "Welcome to Salinas, the salad bowl of the world," and it really is that way. It's literally, you know, lettuce as far as the eye can see. It's very, very interesting. But something interesting about this sign is that you see a little bit closer. This picture was taken on U.S. on the Highway 101. So you have cars and trucks driving right by, and there's dirt, which is right in between the highway and that. This is a strawberry field, but there's lettuce fields also. It blows right into the fields. So, you know, you could be assured that the strawberries in this field are going to be much more highly infested than they are in other fields, let's say, that are much further in. One point to note also is to understand the following thing about greenhouses. Greenhouses are not magical. I heard once from a Rav, who's very close, I think, to Rav Moshe Vai, or some of the big Pesachim in Eretz Yisrael who were involved in Toiloim. He was learning in Eretz Yisrael during the Gulf War. And when this Rav was giving a shmuz after the Gulf War, when he was listing all the nisim that happened at that time, one of the things he mentioned, besides the Scud missiles and everything like that, was this is an Alei Katif or Gush Katif, whatever it was, I think that's when the industry was just starting, said they were matzliach at growing insect-free produce. And, you know, everyone like looked at him like, you know, you've got to be kidding me, you know, Scud missiles and greenhouses being successful. Okay, you know, I'm not going to exactly explain what he, you know, everything he meant, but it definitely makes sense. Greenhouses are very, very, very not magical. It's very, very difficult to get greenhouses.
I'm not following the connection between the scuds and the.
Well, he was saying it's pretty close to a nace that greenhouses were successful in getting produce to be insect free. Uh-huh. They take a lot of work, and even more siyata d'shmaya. Part of the problem is that there's some insects that generally will make their habitat specifically inside greenhouses. Additionally, let's say you do get an infestation in greenhouses, it's very, very difficult to get the bugs out once they're in there because they're in an enclosed environment. You know, in an open field, you spray them, you know, the wind comes, they blow them away. In a greenhouse, you know, the screens keep them out, but they also keep them in. And, you know, I've seen this firsthand many times. You know, greenhouses are a struggle. And for consumers, the most important thing to know is that when you do get greenhouse-grown produce, you have to look at the bag, read the bag carefully, make sure that the hechsherim on the bag are certifying it as being bug-free. Not all of them are. Some of them are saying it has less insects, which is definitely an advantage, but they also give you instructions of how you have to wash the produce in order to make sure that it retains its kashrut status. Some of them with soap, whatever. You have to read the bag, and you should. It's something that consumers should be very careful about. You can keep up to date with all the changes that happen in the industry by going to our website, www.shekforinsects.com. Right now, there's just a short guide which gives all the basic details of what we're going to talk about. We used to have a lot of pictures and videos up there. We're in the middle of redesigning the site and updating it. Hopefully, it should be back up shortly with all the videos. But in the meantime, if you do want any of the videos, you could email, you know, the Star K, and we'd be happy to send them to you. So you can watch them at home as well. But again, you know, it's definitely something that changes. And having said that also, I want to make one more note, is that anything we're going to talk about today is only for North America. Nothing that we said, you know, really, we can't claim that anything we're talking about today applies to Eretz Yisrael. Over there, you have to talk to
that was one of our very first questions, Rabbi Tendler. Can we please address Israel also?
Right, so, you know, I don't know Eretz Yisrael. You know, I'm still trying to, you know, hopefully.
But, I mean, the general rules are the general ideas and what the bugs look like in general.
Yeah,
are the same.
What the bugs look generally are the same. Except the checking procedures are the same, but the levels of infestation and how that affects, right, you know, different produce, you know, you have to speak to the Pesachim in Eretz Yisrael about. I mean, a lot of the procedures were developed in Eretz Yisrael by Roy Vian specifically, but you have to talk to the Pesachim there about specific items. Now, one last note that's on the screen over here is that, you know, we get calls all the time from people, as I mentioned before, let's say about items that are miyut she'eino motzi, that they do find insects in them. Now, as I mentioned, you know, infestation can change. It's very important, we if you find that you're finding things, you know, differently than what we say now, you know, we would love to see the information. If you can document, please, what product you're checking, the country of origin, the store you purchased it at, and any lot number or, you know, other identification information you have about that specific item, and what exactly it is that you found.
Like, for instance, there was a time when red cabbage, we used to say, was not a problem at all.
Right.
It almost was never infested, but now we're saying, you have to check it.
Red cabbage, the newest items which we'll talk about, like pineapples, garlic. There's a few items that, you know, that are brand new, and we do have mashgichim obviously that are checking items on a constant basis. Roman lettuce is, you know, specifically, but a lot of our restaurants which use all types of produce, even items that are not necessarily buggy, but we make them keep logs just so, you know, we keep on top of the latest and most up to date information.
So we're going to show you the pineapples soon, but who would have thought that there would be a problem with pineapples?
Right.
I mean, you can hardly believe it. Okay, so you want to show the, we'll go to the first video?
We're going to set one more screen here.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, fine. Right, so now the first item we're going to talk about are dried items. These items are not motzi, but they do need proper storage. And what that means is that all these items with flour, raisins, dried strawberries, spices, macaroni, rice, cereal, oatmeal, sun-dried tomatoes, these items, you know, there are eggs in these things. We'll show you a video.
Microscopic
eggs in these things. You're not going to be able to find them. But if they're not stored properly, they're stored in warm environments, these items will hatch. The eggs will hatch and you'll end up with an infestation issue. But one other thing to mention is that when I say at the end avoid closeouts, we had someone come into the office one time with a bag of pasta. I don't know if you remember Roy Goldberg. He came to Mincha one time. He showed it to, I was standing with Dr. Pollack, and he showed it to us. There's like these little black specks inside the pasta. He asked us if they were insects. So it didn't look like insects. But Dr. Pollack, you know, put it under the microscope, and turned out they're rodent droppings. And where he ended up, he bought this pasta.
That's a reason to avoid them without the insects.
Right, nothing to do with insects. There's a Baltashaksu issue there, you know, besides insects. So what happened was he had bought this at a closeout, one of these 99-cent stores. And, you know, these items, you know, can be from years ago. We also once had a shiloh, someone brought us a bag of pretzels with a question about a heksher on it. And it didn't look strange, so we did some research on it. We found that the company that produced these pretzels had gone out of business 8 years ago, and they were just selling the pretzels now. So it gives you an idea, you know, if you want to go cheap, you know, there's Target, there's Walmart, there's Costco, there's many good stores that sell, you know, items for cheap, but they also have good quality control programs. You know, closeouts when it comes to food is definitely not something that's a really good idea.
So one of the things we do with the macaroni is, are you going to talk about this, to freeze it?
Yes, that's going to be in the video that we have about infestation. So we have to put the video
on. Yeah, so you can give Hakdama about this one.
Right, so the video again is really shows you what insects look like in flour and other dried items. Again, not that these things are matsui.
Flour generally
does not need to be sifted or checked. But you know, it's important to know what this looks like, you know, because it can change. And you know, for instance, by Hurricane Sandy in Baltimore, also shortly before Hurricane Sandy, we also had a big storm here that knocked out the power for, you know, long periods of time. So, and it was in the summer. A lot of the warehouses that store these items, even the big companies, ended up with some significant issues with insect infestation, and particularly in flour, it became a big problem. So it is important to know what the signs of infestation are in these items, although these are not things that we generally require to be checked on a regular basis.
In America, flour is different, right? Israel, flour is a problem.
Right, and nuts also. You know, again, everything we're talking about is only for items in America.
Now, this video, our provider pulls it in from YouTube, so you'll have to have YouTube enabled on your computer to be able to see this. It runs about 2 minutes.
In the United States, kosher consumers do not need to check flour for infestation at this time. If signs of insect presence are noticed, however, the flour must be checked. This tutorial describes the signs of flour infestation and methods to protect flour products from insects. Special care should be taken by those using flour that has been stored for some time, such as yashin or last year's matzah meal. Often, insect eggs have matured and hatched by this time. Only insects that are visible with the eye present a kashrus problem. This is true even if the bug is not discernible without magnification, but can only be seen as a speck. Insects that cannot be seen at all, such as eggs that are common in flour and other foods, do not present a kashrus problem because of their microscopic size. When opening the flour, notice if there are small holes in the surface. This would indicate the presence of the red or confused flour beetle. These red beetles are easy to see on the surface of the flour, but quickly burrow into the flour when exposed to light or activity. Also watch for small black spots. These beetles are about half the size of the letters on a nickel. It takes a strong magnifying glass or microscope to distinguish them from dirt particles. Often the flour will be speckled with these spots when infested. Look for webbing. Moth larvae produce this webbing where they are feeding. Flour or meal stick to the webbing and is easy to detect by the stringy masses of material. To prevent infestation, many people keep flour in the freezer. This may work if the temperature stays at 0 degrees centigrade for 4 days. At this temperature, the eggs will die. If infested flour is found, scrub containers with soap and hot water. Make sure to remove all the flour particles that adhere to the sides of the container, as these are commonly insect eggs, which are coated with a sticky secretion and become covered with flour. Once cleaned in this way, containers will be safe for use.
So, let's take some... Is there anything you wanted to comment on that video, Rabbi Tamer, first?
We can take some questions.
Let's take some questions. Okay, we'll go to some questions. Let's go to the beginning. The triple washed lettuce that comes without any certification.
We get that question a lot. Triple wash is definitely a good washing process, but those items still definitely have to be checked. A lot of our restaurants and caterers prefer to use those because they come cleaner, but they check them and we find insects in them all the time.
Is it cheaper than let's say, the Starkey certified lettuce?
I'm sure it is. Well, the Starkey certified lettuce, it doesn't really come in food service packs either. So, you know, definitely in restaurants and catering settings, they don't make them in the big bags. But even in small bags, the items without hashgacha, and like the rest of the world, generally are cheaper.
So, which companies make the Starkey lettuce?
Just Dolan Fresh Express.
Dolan Fresh Express.
You know, okay. And one point on that I'll mention now also is that we only certify romaine if it has the Starkey on the bag. There are other items that these companies make, whether it's spinach or spring mix or things like that, which we don't certify at all. And even the romaine has to have the Starkey on the bag because every single lot is checked. But again, we'll talk about that when we get to romaine.
Okay, Saul is asking, DDT did not become a big pesticide until the 1950s. Were people using light boxes before then to check? Probably not.
I wasn't alive back then, so I can't tell you. I do know that, They must have been checking. I mean, look in the Chacham Sod and the Rosh Hashulchan and all the places, and they talk about different items that were being checked. You know, whether infestation, you know, changed since then. I don't know the exact answer to that, but I don't remember. The light box,
it doesn't say in Shulchan Aruch that you have to use a
right,
light box.
Even
today, we're not saying that you have to use a light box. Right. We're just saying it's an effective way that you can, you know, do a good job.
Right, I mean, you could use the sunlight also. You know, you could use any light really would work the same
way. In other words,
way.
if you hold up your lettuce like this to the light, that will also be affected, but it's very tiring.
Right.
It's just easier.
Right, it just make things easier. Now, you know, growing up, you know, I'm not that old. Growing up, the only time of year I remember eating romaine lettuce was Pesach. The rest of the year we had iceberg or things like that who were a lot less, you know, buggy. You know, but again, insect infestation can change, and it's likely that it did.
There's a question about corn on the cob.
Yeah.
Want to talk about that later, or you want to address it?
I will talk about corn on the cob now. So corn on the cob, I know there's been a lot of tumults about corn on the cob. We have had people check in Corn on the Cob, and again, it's not like you never find in Corn on the Cob, but we have not found that it's motzui. That's basically the bottom line.
So we think it's less than 10%.
Right. But again, you know, this is something we constantly in a state of research, and when the corn season starts, we'll be checking it again. And again, look at our website for any updates. We have some alert lists also, but
The advice of the Chochmas Adam is good, that you should look at everything before you eat it. It doesn't mean that you have to go crazy and check everything that carefully, but to look at it before you eat it, not to pay attention.
And this also, I'm sure people know the Sefer Charedin that says that people should be chayshed even for things that are miyachein omotzi. You know, but again, you know, it's not necessarily how we paskin, but you know, people who say they don't like to eat any greens, vegetables, or anything like that, you know, I have only admiration for them. You know, people who are yerushalayim like that, that's for sure.
Anshul is saying that kale in New England is almost always has aphids. Kale, we say you should check
kale.
Kale has to be checked.
Kale is definitely a problem.
Right.
You know, and again, you know, I see from some of the questions, just glancing at them over here, you know, there's really two reasons why we give these types of webinars. There's two groups. There's the people who are, you know, who say that you can't eat anything, in which case, you know, hopefully we'll show you, you know, procedures and ways that you could eat, you know, items as long as you check them properly. And there's people who say on the other end of the spectrum that you can eat anything and this whole thing's a bunch of baloney. So we're not here to sell you any products. We're really here simply just to look at the facts as they are and show you the procedures that we find works to address them.
Yeah, so the question, someone asked a technical question, where can they find this webinar after the webinar is finished? And so after Ms. Debbie Rosenstein finishes editing it and so on, putting it together, you can find it on kosherclasses.org, or we also have it's put up on our we have a YouTube channel, right? Star K Certification. You can search for it there or Vimeo, and it should be up there with all these pictures and everything. Okay, let's go to the next slide.
Okay, next slide we're going to talk about lettuce, greens, all these types of items. Okay, now sample checking, right? So sample checking is allowed. We don't have time to get into all the terror behind it right now. Sample checking is allowed as long as the lot or consignment of produce you want to check is uniform. Now, in order for it to be considered uniform, you need to have the same lot number or date of harvest. And it's also recommended to wash the produce first because obviously then you're going to have a better chance of passing it and there's more guarantee.
Who is this for? For us? For the
everybody.
Consumers?
It's for everybody. Meaning if you're buying, I mean, this is for sure for people using large quantities of it, but you know, we'll talk about differences between that later. But the idea of taking a sample as opposed to checking every single leaf is definitely something that is allowed by halacha. But it has to be done under specific circumstances. You can't just take, you know, three leaves of lettuce and decide after the rest of the day today, none of my lettuce has to be checked. It's not necessarily that simple. And the reason why it's not that simple is because as I mentioned before, every field is different. This is a picture taken, this was in Arizona, actually a few weeks ago, in Yuma, Arizona. So we see something interesting here. You see, first, this is field over here is a field that they just harvested. The field next to it, they can see the mouse, right? Yeah, they can see, this field over here is where they're actually harvesting, that's the harvesting crew right there. Right next to it, a little bit darker green, a little bit higher, is a totally different variety of romaine lettuce. And you know, when I walked in between these different varieties, there's differences between them, you know, in quality, in color, you know, etc. But also differences in infestation. You know, if it's more green, if it was planted a little bit later, you know, it makes a difference in infestation. So therefore, when we talk about uniformity, as the slide mentioned earlier, it has to be from the same lot number or date of harvest. Which basically the idea is that it was planted at the same time and harvested at the same time, and therefore it was subject to all the same field conditions that we mentioned before, and is really going to be uniform in a variety of ways, but including infestation. So if you have a lot that's uniform...
But most people don't buy it like this with a label on it. You go to the store and you buy a head of lettuce. It doesn't come with a...
So that's interesting,
label.
But so, you're right, so then you'd have to
so
check
it's not
each
really...
one. Right, so if there's no way to know that, you know, the two heads that you have, or the three heads, whatever, that you have are uniform, then you're going to have to check each one. The only time you could check it, which is really, the truth is the most popular way people buy lettuce today, I think, I mean, from what I see, is you buy the hearts of romaine which come in a bag, three hearts in a bag or six hearts in a bag, etc. So generally those are going to be uniform.
Oh, I see.
So if let's say you...
Because it has a date on it or a code.
It sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't, but based on the way the industry is set up, the commodity market is set up, you can pretty much assume that the heads in the bag are going to be considered uniform.
You mean if you have one bag, three heads?
One bag, three heads in one bag.
So if you wanted to do a chazaka check, a sample check, then you could do,
let's say, three heads in one bag and assume the rest are going to be clean. But again, the recommended method is to take, let's say you have six heads in a bag, you take all six heads, you wash them all first, and then you check three of them. Okay.
So, person, are we recommending that as an ideal, or ideal to check all of every single head?
Well, if you have small quantities at home, you have six heads, it's more ideal to check everything, because there could be, and I've personally seen this myself, you know, not tremendous amount, not enough that we would have to be choshish for it every single time, but there definitely could be variances in the commodity market. Sometimes they do, you know, put two different varieties in a bag or from two different lots. Now, they have a cheshbon on it for traceability purposes, but it could happen that you have from two different lots in one bag.
So, a person buying a small amount for home use,
right, should just check everything.
Recommended to check every head.
Recommended to check every single head, right? That's always the best thing to do. Okay, so step one when you want to check is, again, wash your produce, okay? Wash it all. Using soap is the best thing because it kills, removes insects. Now, Dr. Pollack also said an additional bonus of washing your produce with soap, and that is that it kills the bacteria that's on it, and it spoils, you know, it doesn't spoil as fast. But that's always the best thing to use. The veggie washers that they sell in the stores are good at removing pesticides and things like that, but they're not really good enough they're not really potent enough to remove the insects. The reason why the insects are removed, we actually have a very close connection with the local Department of Entomology at University of Maryland. They're actually very, very helpful. I'll mention Dr. Leslie Pick. She was extremely helpful in helping us do research and develop different procedures. And the reason why insects are removed from produce is when they get killed. So the amount of soap or veggie wash or et cetera that you're going to use in the water to be effective at removing insects has to be enough that it's going to be lethal to the bugs, which most of them are not. They're only enough to remove the pesticides or any dirt, but they're not really enough to remove insects. So soap is really, really the best way to
go. Food grade soap.
Food grade soap, obviously. Now,
like a dishwashing, you have a recommendation, right? A dishwashing.
No, any soap. For washing, any soap you want. Any soap is good. They have a lot. They have a lot of non-toxic soaps out there, and obviously those are going to be recommended. Salt and vinegar. We get this question all the time. That's the definitely the old way. A lot of people have done it. Personally, I don't find it works as well. Unless you're using, extremely high quantities, which again will be lethal for the insects, but it will also, make the lettuce not taste so good. We find that the soap is really what works best. But again, the idea of washing the produce is, as we mentioned before, mainly really to give it the best chance you have to pass to get it as clean as possible before you check it. It also adds a level of uniformity to it, which, you don't really need to. You're not looking at this point to get all the bugs off, although it definitely would be the best thing you can do. Another aspect of washing the produce is that it's important to know that the time to check your lettuce is only after you wash it. If you go to a field with unwashed lettuce, you're always going to find bugs there. But that's not when you're obligated to check. You're obligated to check the lettuce, and I'm not going to get into all the technical details of this. But it's a chiyuv gavra, which means that whenever I'm ready to eat the produce, that's when I'm ready to check it. So first thing you always do is wash your produce, and after that is when you're going to get ready to check the produce. So that's step one, is wash the produce. Step two is now you're going to check the produce. The preferred method is what we call a shmata b'dika, which we'll show you in a minute how that's done. It's developed by Rabbi Vaya in Eretz Yisrael. Now the items you need for the shmata b'dika is a basin, is a thrip cloth, as pictured, which is why it's called a shmata. It's really a thrip cloth, or it's a mesh, which is like a filter cloth, about 60 microns. A light box, which is helpful, and a loop, which is also helpful. Now, the traditional way of checking, let's say Roman lettuce
A loop is a magnifying
glass. A loop is a magnifying glass, correct. The traditional way of checking Roman lettuce, which is on a light box, leaf by leaf, or holding it up to the light, is not something that's invalid. The only reason that we don't like it so much anymore is that it's very easy to miss things unless you really have a lot of patience and you really have a lot of time on your hands, which, I think the biggest, most busy time of the year for this is Erev Pesach, which, most people are definitely, if they're not short on time, they're short on patience Erev Pesach, one way or the other, and therefore the Shemata B'dika we found is much more, really Revaya found, is much more effective and actually easier. You could do a lot more.
Someone's asking, doesn't the water obscure the bugs? So
We'll show you how to do it. Now, these light boxes are available for purchase at the Star K offices. They're also available in some Judaica stores. The thrip cloths are actually not so easy to find. You can't buy them online, really. The companies that sell them, you have to buy huge rolls of it at a time. I think there are some stores, I heard from one of our mashgiach from New York, there are some stores in New York that do sell them. We also do sell them here in the office. You can call the front desk at 410-484-4110, and they could sell you any of the items pictured except the bins. The bins, you know, you're welcome to go to your local store, and you know they should have a wide variety of different types of bins available. But any of the, so to speak, specialty items that you need for Shemata Bedika, you know, you can buy them directly from the Star K. There's actually a picture of the Rav or behind him in Shlita actually doing a Shemata Bedika when we were researching pineapples fairly recently. The soap I used in the, as I mentioned on the video, the best soap to use in the Shemata Bedika is dishwasher soap. Like that's used in an electric dishwasher. They do sell plenty of non-toxic ones. The reason why is because they don't make any bubbles and therefore it does not obscure the water, even though you're pouring it through the cloth, but it's definitely, bubbles just get in the way. So that's always the best soap to use. Now people ask about a cheesecloth or something like that. So cheesecloths generally have a much larger mesh size than the mesh size that we're talking about over here with the thrip cloth or shmata. Therefore, you know, if a cheesecloth has a mesh size that's small enough, then 100% you can use it. But generally, the mesh cloth that we have here is 60 microns, which we find is the most effective one to make sure you're catching all the insects and not missing anything.
So now you put it onto the thrip cloth on the light box.
Right.
And now you're going to show us what you're looking for.
Right. So now let's get into what are we looking for? So it's important to understand we're only talking about insects that are nirlei naim. They're visible to the naked eye. We're not talking about things that are too small to be seen, because obviously the Torah, in the Torah of Malachi Asharis, the Torah was not, you know, we're not angels. We can't be expected to avoid eating things that we can't possibly see. Now it's judged by size only, and that means is that even if a aphid turns green or a thrip turns red on a strawberry, which is true, they can do that. Then it doesn't necessarily mean that that's considered invisible. They are visible size-wise, you just have to know how to find them. And if it hides in crevices, it's still usser. However, also at the same time, is that even if it's very, very small, maybe even too small to be considered nirlei naim, if it walks around, and therefore you can see this little speck walking around, that is considered a nirlei naim.
If you can see it.
Right, so you know, once you have that aspect in the picture, it really, you know, pushes the limits really down as far as what's considered nirlei naim. You know, one recent example that we'll show you now is about pineapple mites, which are actually very, very small. But I'll show you in a second. But one last, based on a question also, is that, you know, and I have it on the slide here also, that loops and light boxes are not you being used to find insects that you can't otherwise see. It's just really to make tools to make it easier and more efficient to check the produce.
But by using a paper towel instead of a 60 micron mesh cloth, probably not going to withstand the
water.
It's going to break.
It'll rip right through.
Pour through.
Right through. The meshes that we sell are reusable, by the way. So it's,
you know, yes, definitely can be reused.
Definitely can be reused. So this is actually an actual picture of a mite on a pineapple.
That's not the size.
That's a little bit magnified.
We have a video of it, right?
Yeah, we have a video
of it. Okay, so we're going to show you that right now.
So even if this bug might be a little bit too small, but once you see this, suddenly you see it.
This is on pineapple?
This is on a piece of pineapple.
Right. Okay, so when you see it moving...
When you see it moving, obviously that's going to be considered nirlei naim. And therefore, you know, based on this is, you know, why we changed our policy on pineapple, right. but we'll go through that.
When you look at it, I mean, this is much enlarged.
This is much enlarged.
What enlargement is there? What magnification is?
This I don't know. This was actually taken one of our mashgichim in New York. I'm not sure exactly what size he magnified it at. I mean, we have microscopes here that can magnify things up to 800 times. Not that something that's only visible under that level of magnification is nirlei naim, but you know,
it helps you know what you're talking.
It helps
about.
You know what we're talking. Right. About, know what we're looking for. Now the truth is that as I mentioned that as I'll mention now really, you know, all this, you know, no one's going to walk out of this webinar being an expert, right? It's something that takes practice, it takes a decent set of eyes, and it takes patience. And I always recommend people, the only thing I recommend organic produce for is practicing, getting to know what the insects look like. And if you practice enough, you'll develop a tvias ein, you'll develop a good eye to know exactly that, you know, this speck or whatever, I used to think it was a piece of dirt, but now I know that that's an insect, and you can see them very, very clearly. You know, our mashkichim who are well-trained, they have loops, but they really can find the insects even without them. Because they know what they're looking for.
Once you become used to it, you get more
of an
expert.
Once you become used to it, you become an
right.
expert.
But the fact that only an expert can see it, if only an expert can see it.
No, it's not that only an expert can see it, it's just that you just
need
have
some
to
training.
Use, you need some practice.
Right.
You need some training, you need some practice.
There's a certain form of an insect, like
right.
it has legs.
Right,
it
you just have to learn what insects
right.
look like.
Right.
It's not a rocket science. It's really something that most people, as long as their eyes are Baruch Hashem good, you know, they can do it properly. You just have to practice a little bit and get used to knowing what the bugs look like.
That was on a fresh pineapple, right?
That was a fresh pineapple.
Right. Is there a problem with dried, or that's not really?
We have not seen a problem with dried pineapple.
Okay, now we're going to show you the lettuce.
The lettuce video. So this video will show you what the insects look like, the most commonly found insects look like.
Three main species found on lettuce and other leafy vegetables: aphids, thrips, and flies. Aphids are small, round, green bugs. Very difficult to see with the naked eye, their color and size allows them to become virtually invisible on the host leaf. Most aphids measure about 1 millimeter in length, about the size of the letters on a nickel. To properly check for aphids, it is advisable to use a light box. The thicker insect remains dark while light passes through the leaf. Thrips are small, elongated brown insects. Roughly the same length as an aphid, these pests are only half the width. Easily mistaken for a piece of dirt, it takes some practice to recognize what is an insect and what is not. In the beginning, many find it helpful to have a magnifying glass or jeweler's loop on hand to confirm the actual identity of the speck. Thrips move very quickly and may run under curls in the leaf when exposed to light. Vegetable flies resemble houseflies. About twice the size of aphids and thrips, this black, winged insect is the easiest to find.
There are other insects that are not shown here. There are mites, and there could be beetles and different types of things that could be found in different types of lettuce, but these are generally the most commonly found insects. And again, you know, once you're doing the check, once you're checking and you're getting used to knowing what the insects look like, you know, if there's anything else on there, you'll find it on the bedik, on the shmata. So that is really, as far as Romi lettuce is concerned, you know, the shmata bedik is the method that we use for many different items. And we're going to go now through some specific items. I might go a few minutes over time, but go through some specific items and how to check them. And we'll make reference to using the shmata bedik with thrip cloth method, but now at least you'll know what we're talking about. The first item is to talk about is asparagus. So there's two items in asparagus that need to be checked. One is, you know, under the leaves, along the stems, along the stalks, so and then also in the tips. The way you check it is you have to really peel open, you know, each leaf along the side and check under there, because many times you could find thrips under there. Now, if you want to just peel those sides, you can avoid checking the sides completely. Some of our caterers prefer peeling the sides because they find it looks classy when it changes the shade of green on the sides and it makes it look nice. And as far as the top is concerned, the tips, you do a shmata bedika on the tips, again, in the water.
So you swish it in the water.
Swish it in the water. And then
the
you
soapy
get
water.
The soapy water. And then you check the
and
water
then
over
you
the
throw
shmata.
It through the shmata.
Through
and check
the shmata.
It. Do we say it's still that you can, if you have a bunch, that you can just check three out of a bunch?
No, it has to be three servings, which basically
three
is a whole
servings.
Bunch of asparagus.
Oh,
the entire
okay.
bunch has to be checked.
I see.
Now, if, as I mentioned on the slide, if you're going to peel or shave the sides and cut off the tips, like many places, restaurants do that for sushi, you don't have to do anything. It doesn't have to be checked at all, which, you know, some people prefer to do it that way.
So Sarah's asking, can I use this simple children's microscope to learn? Do I have to get a loop?
Loops are quite cheap, actually.
It's like $5.
We sell them here for $5. You might even be able to find them for cheaper on Amazon. They're extremely cheap. They have a 40x magnification and they're 25 millimeters around, so they give you a really good visual on what you're looking for. They're cheap, they're easy to use, it's not really such a major investment. Light boxes may be a little bit more expensive, but, you know, even that, someone mentioned before also about buying light boxes in photography stores, which you can do. I believe they're much more expensive there than what we sell them for here.
What do we sell them for?
I think like 38 or something like that, you know.
Basically cost.
It's basically cost, yeah. The next item we'll talk about is barley, which you mentioned briefly before. So right now we're not finding that barley really has an infestation issue. It does change sometimes. Last year there was a major issue with barley, particularly people who are mapped on Yashan, and we call it high risk because they're generally stored for a long time and could end up with infestation issues. But the checking method for barley is really quite simple.
You have to be more careful with the Yashan barley.
You have to be more careful with the Yashan barley.
Because it has to sit.
Right, it has to sit around.
By definition, it has to be sitting.
It has to be sitting around the storehouses. Right. And checking is very simple. You simply just put it in a bowl of water and let it soak for about 10 to 15 minutes. And any insects that are there will float to the top, like you see in this picture. You know, this is obviously a very highly infested bag, but you know, these are the types of things that you're going to find, that you might find if your barley is infested. You know, there's beetles, there's grubs, there's pupa, which is really immature stages of insects. This is what the top of the water, this is a picture taken of barley soaking in water, what the water looks like, you know, if it's infested. But you'll see it right away. This is not something that takes a lot of training to know how to do.
And the storage issues in your own home are also a concern.
Right,
when you bring it home, don't leave it in the closet in the warm area.
Right, don't leave it on top of your refrigerator, which is very common.
Put it in this, like an airtight box.
Put an airtight box in a cool, dry environment. Uh-huh. That's the best place to store it. Many people just stick it in your freezer. You know, supermarkets, you know, have to be careful also to make sure it's stored properly. But the truth is, you know, this is a kosher concern per se, but any company, even a big company, let's say spice companies that we certify, I've been to them, and many spice companies, they're very cognizant of this problem, and they make sure to store their items in special conditions where it's very cool.
We said that the webinar is going to go about an hour, but I think we're going to have to go overtime. I assume that those who can't stay will be able to watch the video, but I think we can keep going with another half an hour.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I mean, we'll go till we finish.
Okay.
Well, those of you who can stay, you're welcome to stay, and if not, you can watch it afterwards, as Rabbi Goldberg said.
Should barley be soaked in soapy water?
No, it does not need to be soapy water. Just be regular water.
Why soak for 15 minutes? Why the bugs come up instantly?
They don't always, because sometimes they get stuck. You know, if you're putting, like, you know, you have a bowl this high, and then you put the barley in, so the barley is this high, it takes them a few minutes for the water to get down into the in between the barley kernels and get the bugs out.
Are we recommending that you soak your barley now? Is that our official?
There was
a time when we absolutely
last year we absolutely insisted on it. We have been checked. We do constantly check it.
Our places meaning Starcase.
Our Starcase establishments do constantly check it. But we have not been finding. So, you know, we can't say you're required to check barley right now at this time. But we do have it in our guide, and we do always mention it because it's something people should be aware of. Again, it's something that's very easy to do.
Yehuda says use hot water for the barley. We don't use hot. We don't require hot water. Would that start cooking it?
We haven't found there's a major difference between using hot water or cold water. Mm-hmm. But again, it's something that's easy to do. You know, it's something that, you know, why not do it? Most people soak their beans and barley anyways before they put it into the challan. So, you know, you'll never lose by soaking it. How about that? The next item, we're moving along in alphabetical order, is broccoli. Now, broccoli, I'm going to start from the bottom of the skull. And as it takes practice, broccoli is very difficult. It's not something that I can say, definitely not after watching this webinar, I'd recommend for anybody to do in their own home. There are, you know, varieties of frozen broccoli with hechsherim on there that have checked it already, you know, Bodek, Eden, etc. You know, that's probably the better way to go. And the reason why broccoli is more difficult is you can imagine that it's tight, the bugs get stuck in the florets, and it's not something that's very easy to check. However, the methodology is pretty similar. However, here, part of the procedure is a warm pre-soak or a wash for about at least 20 minutes beforehand. In our restaurants, they usually do it twice in soapy water for at least 20 to 30 minutes. That is really simply just to loosen up the heads and get them a little bit looser before you even check it. Many of our restaurants, I'll just mention because, you know, in my other life, I actually in charge of the restaurants in Baltimore. Most of our restaurants do not use fresh broccoli just because of the simple time it takes to, you know, process it and check it. But the procedure is really, again...
What are they using? Nothing.
Either they're using nothing, using frozen.
Frozen, they still have to check it.
Frozen from the Hamish companies that have checked it already. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, if I mention any brands, it's not, you know, I'm not saying any one brand to the exclusion of any other. You know, if there's a Hechsher on it that takes a Charias, you know, if there's no insects in it, you know, generally speaking, it should be fine. If anyone has any specific questions, they can feel free to call our office. But again, the procedure for checking broccoli is the same thing. Once it's loosened up, you know, you use the shmata method. You need to agitate it, you know, very, very strongly, and you have to let it soak in the checking water for 10 to 15 seconds, because you really want to make sure the water is able to penetrate through the floret. And also, we don't allow sample checking on broccoli. Every single head has to be checked, and the reason is because it's very hard. The bugs get in there, they get stuck in there. It's very hard to consider broccoli based on a lot number to be uniform. And again, it's something that we developed after visiting broccoli fields, you know, out in California and other places. So it's not something we do sample checking for. Every head has to be checked. So as you can imagine, it takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of practice. But that is the procedure for broccoli. The next item on the list is iceberg and cabbage. Iceberg and cabbage has pros and cons. The pros of it is that it's a closed head. It's completely enclosed. There's less insects.
As opposed to romaine.
Opposed to romaine or other ones where it grows open.
Right.
It's less green, so it has less nutrition. It's also less tasty. We don't like it as much. Insects don't like it as much, which is a fact. It's also a harder consistency, so the insects don't cling to it as well as they would cling to, let's say, a softer leaf, a tender leaf like spinach or romaine or something. However, there are some cons, not necessarily more than anything else, but iceberg does grow open initially. That's actually a picture of iceberg growing in the field in the premature stages, and then by the time it's finished, it grows into a closed head like that. So the inner leaves are the newest leaves that are inside. It grows from, it closes up, and then the leaves grow inside the head. So the con of that is that an initial stage, if insects get in there and then it closes up, they're never coming out. And therefore, you can find, and that they could have babies, they could lay eggs inside, you could have more insects inside. You can find insects all the way to the core of a head of iceberg lettuce or cabbage. And therefore, if you're going to check iceberg and cabbage, the way it used to be set over just in the veld was that you take the first three leaves off, check them. If they're fine, you use the rest of the head.
The inside doesn't have.
It's not true. If it has, you'll have all the way through to the inside. And, you know, we check cabbage, obviously, in all the restaurants. And when we find all the way through to the inside many times. So the procedure for checking it is, first of all, how much. So if you have a case of iceberg, you could check, you know, which is not usually happen. It doesn't usually happen in your own home. But let's say in a restaurant or caterer, you take three heads, unwashed, obviously, because it's not going to help to wash a closed head. You check three heads. If you don't find any, then you can use the rest in that case. In the next case, you do the same thing. If you have single heads, again, you have to check the whole head, which means you have to peel the whole head and check the entire head all the way through.
So a typical home would have
one head, right?
Heads,
you know, Yontif, you'll make stuffed cabbage or things like that where you need to freeze it. So you have to check the entire head. You're having a couple of heads, you should check each one. Because it's hard to know whether they're going to be uniform if you buy them in the store, just a couple of heads, you know, sitting in the bin. Now, even if you're freezing it, you still do need to check it. We get that question a lot. If you're freezing it, does it kill the insects? Freezing does not kill insects. It definitely doesn't destroy insects. Insects are still, we have a company we certify that freezes produce down to negative 20 degrees. And we still find perfectly preserved insects inside afterwards.
But we had before with the macaroni, we recommended to put it in the freezer. That's because it kills the eggs.
It kills the eggs, right.
You leave it there for what, 2 days,
three days.
3 days. You put your...
4 days, sorry. 4 days.
4 days?
4 days, it said, yeah. That's not even our...
How many minutes?
96 hours. That is actually based on, it's University of Arkansas particularly, but many others, there's a lot
of kills
university
the eggs,
research that
kills the
eggs.
But it doesn't kill the bugs.
It doesn't kill
them. Okay.
I mean, it might, sometimes it will kill the bugs, but they're going to preserve the bugs. A dead bug is also lesser to eat,
right.
So you're not going to...
And these eggs that we're talking about are microscopic, so
right.
It's only a problem if they hatch.
Right.
Okay.
So that is as far as iceberg and cabbage is concerned. I see someone meant, what about radicchio? Radicchio is very similar to iceberg and cabbage. Because it is a closed head and it has the same harder consistency. Now, the next thing on the list is celery. So celery, you can find insects, you know, first of all the leaves, but most people I think cut off the leaves. Some people like to put the leaves in soup. If you're gonna use the leaves, they have to be checked just like, you know, lettuce or any other herb. But the rest of the celery, which is really just the stalks, has to be rinsed well. There will many times be insects on it, but because of this hard consistency, they don't stick in. They will be rinsed. They will rinse right off. As far as leaf miners is concerned, we'll talk about that when we get to scallions
a little bit more.
Leaf miners are a type of insect. We have some pictures later on about them. They burrow their way into the skin of the produce and they don't come out. So you can't wash them out. You can see them very easily. They leave a squiggly trail, which is very easily to spot. We have not found it to be matzoi in celery, so we don't require it to be checked.
If you see it, you'll see it very easily.
I'll show you some slides of when we get to scallions, what they look like. But we do not find that it's matzoi in celery. We don't find it's matzoi in romaine lettuce either. We have a place that actually checks for leaf miners in romaine lettuce, and the instance of infestation of leaf miners, as you said, is without a shadow of a doubt less than 1%.
Anne is asking that, are we saying that dead bugs are okay to eat? We're not saying that they're okay to eat when they're dead at all.
No, absolutely.
That's always
not
a problem. But
no.
We were talking about the freezing of the eggs
right.
That which are microscopic, and those are not a problem unless they hatch, and then you could be able to see them. But if you freeze the macaroni.
If you're keeping it for a long time, stick it in the freezer for 4 days.
So then it would kill them.
Right,
but dead bugs are just as prohibited as live bugs.
Right. I mean, you stick it in the freezer for 4 days, and then as long as it stays in a cool, dry condition and sealed well, you're not going to have an issue.
There's just so many questions that we can't get. There was another question about wasari, about that. We'll, if you have any further questions after the webinar, please feel free to email us info@star-k.org or call us 410-484-4110, as long as we're giving out this information. This webinar is held once a month at the end of every month, the last Wednesday at noon. And if you would like to be informed about the topic, go to our website, star-k.org, and sign up for our alerts, and we'll send you all the details. There was another question, interesting, about the bags of lettuce that are come with a certification. They're certified, and they have sometimes clumps of lettuce in there. So, was that checked? How could it be checked if it's closed?
And the answer is that because we didn't necessarily check the lettuce that's in that bag, we took samples, everybody else does, we took samples from that lot, and a lot of samples, big samples, and checked it.
There isn't anybody who checks every leaf.
Right,
the lettuce would cost like $50 a bag.
Sample checking is very valid, both in halacha and in mitzias. And that lot was checked and found to be insect-free, so even if there's some clumps in it, it's not going to be a concern.
Okay, go ahead.
The next item on the list is going to be garlic. So garlic is a very new item to the insect world, and that is because what we do found that it is matzoi, at least right now. Last few months we've been checking, based on it coming from China and California, different locales, wherever it's found. Argentina, I don't know if as much, but... it's hard to know where you're getting your garlic from. You go to the store, just a big bin of garlic. But we are finding it's matsui, that there are mites, there's a picture right there. That's a mite on a garlic loaf. The mites are in between the layers of the peel. But if you're using just the cloves, that's not a problem at all. The most common question we get about garlic is people like to take the whole clove, put some olive oil in and stick it in the oven and roast the whole cloves together.
With the peel?
The whole head, with the peels on it.
Oh, the whole thing.
Right, they roast it together and it gets soft and you put it in your challah and it's delicious.
I see.
But it's not something we recommend doing anymore.
So you could take each individual clove?
You take individual clove, right? It's recommended to rinse it off after you peel it, mm-hmm. just to make sure there's no mites still on there. And that's really all you have to do. So it's pretty easy enough to deal with. Next thing is grapes. So grapes, the problem with grapes is that there are mites on the grape skins. However, we have found, and after consulting with a lot of the people who did the research, is that once it's rinsed well, it does not seem that they're matzoi at all anymore. What I mean rinse well doesn't mean with soap, it doesn't mean take off each individual grape. What it means is, the way I used to wash grapes, take the whole bag, you swish it under the sink, and that's it. Now you really have to wash them well. You have to wash them in a stream of water. Just make sure they're washed well, and that's no further checking is required. That applies to both green and red grapes. Moving right along to mushrooms. So the mushroom issue is really only in the fan area. It's really on the fan area, which is where the arrow is pointing over there. However, we're not really finding so much that it's matzui. We have mashgichim again constantly checking these items. And we don't really find that it reaches the levels where it would be considered matzi.
There are some who say that the large, fancy mushrooms have more infestation than the typical button mushrooms.
It's possible,
but we don't require
anything more than a
rinse.
So just
wash it.
Just rinse it well, pay attention to the fan area, and that's really all you have to do. Now the one that a lot of people, I'm sure the reason a lot of you are tuning into this is for pineapples. So the problem with pineapples is a real problem. There are mites that are found on the outer rind and inside the blossom cups. For those of you who don't know pineapple terminology, I actually just learned it recently myself. The blossom cups are these little brown, they look like cups, literally, you know, that go into the skin, which are after you peel the pineapple, this is what is left over. And also inside the crown and on the outside of the pineapple. We're finding mites. And, you know, right now, all the pineapples that...
How often do you find them?
So we have found, it varies. It varies. We have found some pineapples that we found 50, 60 to 100 mites on one pineapple, and some we found less. It's hard to know exactly what the reason is. Right now, all the pineapples are coming from Costa Rica. Will be the same thing when they start coming from Hawaii or other Mexico or other locales. I don't know. Again, you have to keep paying attention to our website, checkforinsects.com. We'll update the information as we find it. But you know, right now, this is what the facts are. The solution is really you have to peel the pineapple well until only yellow fruit is visible. And you should also rinse off the cutting board and knife, because we have found, you put the pineapple down on the cutting board, you end up with mites. They crawl around, you end up with mites on the cutting board. We found that many times. And the rind, which is the outside peel of the pineapple, and the crown, should not be used. Like for decorative platters, you know, it just shouldn't be used because they do harbor lots of insects. So here is a picture of a pineapple that's not properly peeled, has the blossom cups there and there, and here's one that's that it is properly peeled. These little holes over here are not a problem. But you just have to be able to see only yellow on the fruit, and that should be enough.
Laura's asking about the portobello mushrooms. We don't have a problem with that, right?
Right, same thing.
Okay, same as the regular. That's what I thought.
The next item is scallions and leeks. So scallions and leeks, there's two issues with them. One is thrips, which are found in a few places. One is in between the layers, in between the seams where the leaves come together. So that is one. The second place they're found is inside the tubes. Mm-hmm. And they can go as far down all the way into the bulb. That's one problem. The second problem is leaf miners, which we do find matsui in scallions. But leaf miners are very easy to check for. This is what they look like. They leave this squiggly trail, and that's the leaf miner right there.
How
still
does he
inside.
Get it from the outside?
He burrows his way in from the outside.
Right. So if you see that kind of...
Right, so the solution over here is again, not so complicated. One is that you check the inside of the tubes as far down as you're going to use. Meaning if you want to use all the way into the bulb, you slice the tube and check all the way down into the bulb in between the layers. To see if there's any thrips there. And I also check, like the picture here is shown, in between the leaves, pull apart the leaves where they come together and check right there. That's as far as thrips is concerned. For leaf miners, you check each one. A visual check on the outside. You know, this is another picture of what a leaf miner trail looks like. They're pretty easy to find. And again, if you see it, you know, you really, if there's no thrip problem, if there's only a leaf miner issue, you really just have to cut off, you know, that piece and not use it. This particular picture, it's hard to see if the leaf miner is even still in there or not. If it's not even in there, it might not even be an issue. It's probably not even an issue anyway, but, you know, you probably just rip off this piece or just don't use that particular scallion.
I think most people would just throw it out.
I'm not going to fight you on that or go over. The next item on the list are strawberries, fresh or frozen. The problem is thrips. They're very small, and this mites. It's very interesting, you know. I found significant differences between strawberries from California and Florida and Maryland, just different types of insects. Maryland, primarily, there were a lot of mites. California was primarily a lot of thrips. But again, you know, you get organic strawberries, or I mean, you can find aphids on there, you can find anything on there, but primarily the main problem on strawberries is the thrips. Now, thrips come in various stages.
This is a relatively new problem, only a couple of years that we discovered this, right? 10 years ago, nobody was talking about
That's for sure.
So either nobody noticed, and they were there. It's possible.
You know, these are very much an early name. I've shown strawberries.
You can certainly see the move, as we're going to show.
Yeah, we'll show you certainly the move, but you can even see them. Yeah, you know, they like to hide. They're hard to spot. They're usually the baby thrips, the nymph stage thrips, which if you look on our website, checkforinsects.com, on the last page of the guide, there's a lot of pictures there. Shows you the various stages of thrips, what they go through in their development. This is the earlier stages. So they're translucent, which makes them very hard even to find using a shmata bedika, because they're translucent. You know, you could find them using that method. The best way to do it is to check the strawberry just holding in your hand. But the solution we found is actually quite simple, and this is a very extensive research we did on strawberries over, you know, a long period of time throughout the various seasons, which is really the only way to develop procedures for anything, is not just to choose one season, is to check it throughout the year, because the seasons, you know, things change depending on the locale where it comes from. Is to wash the strawberries in soapy water. The official number we give is 2 tablespoons of soap per gallon of water. Now, you're not checking the water for anything, so you could use any dish soap, which has bubbles even, or, you know, as long as it's non-toxic. That's
so you're just trying. You're just trying to get rid of the bugs.
You're just trying to get rid of the bugs. Right.
It's slippery.
Right, the water should feel slippery. It should be not, you know, don't be fooled by bubble in the soapy water for 1 minute. Does not have to be more, but it should not be less either. Again, you agitate them a little bit in the water, let them soak there for 1 minute, and rinse them off, and no further checking is required.
We have the video?
Yeah, we have the video. It's recommended to cut off the top, but the truth is that if you do this procedure, then you don't have to really even cut off the top. It does is effective even at that stage. And we have a video we can show you also that will demonstrate this, what these insects look like in a clearer way, and also the procedure.
Strawberry insects are very small and difficult to see. About 1 millimeter, or a 25th of an inch in length, to the naked eye, these bugs resemble tiny white grains of rice, a fraction the size of a strawberry seed. These insects are usually found near the top of the berry. They hide in places that match their own white color, such as the base of the greens, or in the depression created by a seed. To properly clean strawberries, wash them in soapy water. Vigorously agitate the water. Rinse off the strawberries well. Finally, it is preferable to cut off the top with a small amount of the flesh.
Common question that people ask all the time is that should you wash them before you cut off the tops or after you cut off the tops? And practically speaking, it's better to do it, better to wash them before you cut off the tops. And the reason is because if you cut off the tops, a lot of times you'll have a hole in the strawberry. And if you wash them then in soapy water, you're never going to get the soap out of the strawberry unless you cut it, slice it in half. And another misnomer also about strawberries is that people think that only bugs are found on the top, so if you cut off the tops, you don't even have to wash them. That's not true. You can find them anywhere, anywhere on the strawberry. We have Ashgacha on frozen strawberry companies where we go and check. I spend usually a good part of my springtime in one of our facilities in California checking strawberries. Frozen strawberries really are, you know, just fresh strawberries. They wash and stick them in the freezer, so if they don't wash them well, and get rid of the insects, you know, the fact that they freeze them doesn't help you at all. So therefore, frozen strawberries do need to have a hechsher that has addressed the concern of any insect issues.
We have a couple of pertinent questions. Does the water have to be a certain temperature?
The best water to use in general, when everything except broccoli, is going to be cold water, because if you use hot water, you're going to ruin the produce.
Mm-hmm. Okay, fair enough. There was another question here, but it got lost. Okay, can strawberries be washed on Shabbos? And the answer is no.
Strawberries
cannot be washed on Shabbos. Because if you're washing to get rid of the bugs,
right.
if you already did the process before Shabbos, right. And there's no bugs to be on it, and you're just washing them because you just want to washing them, then that would be fine. But if you're doing it to get rid of the bugs, that would be forbidden.
Right, and that's really applies to anything like that on Shabbos. I mean, you're allowed to wash your produce, let's say tomatoes on Shabbos from Reza Tshuva. You can wash it because that's the way you eat it, but if you're washing it specifically to get rid of the insects, you can't do that. So you also can't do Shmata B'dika on Shabbos either, because again, you're putting in the water and with the intention of getting off the insects.
And Elisheva is asking, is this true for checking strawberries in Israel as well? I think we should reiterate that it's not.
Right, now, nothing we're talking about here applies to Eretz Yisrael.
So if you do that in Israel, this wouldn't be necessarily sufficient.
It wouldn't necessarily be sufficient. I don't know what the Mitzvah is in Eretz Yisrael. Last time I was in Eretz Yisrael...
I think he says you have to peel them.
You have to peel them, it could be. Nothing we're saying here necessarily applies to Eretz Yisrael. You have to ask the local Rabbanim there.
What about worms inside the cavity of the strawberry?
We have not found that.
They would only be able to get in there
If there's a hole in it, right?
If there's a hole. So if you cut off the top, and now you created a hole...
I've done that many times. Again, we did a research project with thousands and thousands and thousands of strawberries throughout, almost an entire year. We constantly do it also. I don't find that it really makes a difference. People say that you cut off the top, then the bug gets inside. Maybe, but again, you should wash it before... Another reason why you should wash it before you cut off the tops. Now, two items which unfortunately should not be used are artichokes or artichoke hearts. The bottom, which is just the stem, are fine. Artichokes are very hard to check. The bugs are in between all the various layers of leaves there. I don't think you will find them with a hashgacha, really. You'll find the bottoms with hashgacha, but the hearts, I'm not sure if you can find them with hashgacha, even canned. And Brussels sprouts. Brussels sprouts are like cabbages, but they're, if you want to take them apart and check them, you can do that. But otherwise, there's not really much you can do if you want to eat the whole Brussels sprout. There's no real way to check it. There are some Jewish companies that have Brussels sprouts, with reliable hashgachas that have addressed the tolerance issue. Either they go into greenhouses, or they harvest them at certain times of the year from certain places where they make sure there's no insect issue, and those would be fine. But otherwise, the fresh Brussels sprouts would not be recommended.
And we have frozen artichoke hearts are also a problem.
They don't
really come with a certificate.
Frozen produce, spinach, anything like that is no different than fresh.
There's one thing that we didn't cover that a few people are asking is about the herbs, the basil and the...
Right, so herbs are the same thing as lettuce, really, as romaine lettuce. You have to wash them and check them the same way using Shmata B'dika.
They can be very infested, right?
Yeah. A lot of times they are very highly infested, particularly cilantro and parsley and things like that. I know one of the companies...
So let's just go back. Did we cover this? So you do the Shmata method, right? And you find bugs. And then what? So now
thank you for bringing that up.
I don't think we covered that. Right. And then, now what? I found bugs.
Right, so let's say you did your Shmata B'dika on one of these items and you found insects. Now what? So what you have to do is you take all the produce, rinse it, and then try checking it again in Shmata B'dika a second time.
Right, so this is not only a checking method, it's also a cleaning method. The soap, washing with the soapy water.
So one advantage of using soap in the Shmata B'dika water is that you have to wash your produce off anyways at this point before you eat it. So if you do find insects, what you should do is rinse it off well and then try checking it again, putting it back in the soapy water of the Shmata B'dika, the whole method again.
So not only will it check, but it also could be getting rid of the bugs.
Correct.
And we say that if you did that three times and you still find
then you should not use it
because it's obviously so infested that your system is not working.
Right. Now, if you're using large quantities, let's say in restaurants, for instance, in our restaurants, particularly by broccoli, what the mashgiach will do is, he'll just pull a few heads while the produce truck is still sitting there, before he even leaves. He pulls a few heads or whatever the produce is out of the box and checks it without washing it, just to check it, and just to see how infested is this produce. Mm-hmm. Because if on the first check... even if you wash and then you check it, if you find, if it's loaded with insects, you're probably just wasting your time to try to get it to pass. If it fails with 2-3 insects, okay, so if you wash it, hopefully you'll get it to pass. But if you take broccoli, I actually had it with basil, you put it in the water, and 50, 60, it was unbelievable how many thrips were in the basil. You're never going to get it to pass. You're just going to waste your time. You'll wash it again and again and again. You're never going to get it to pass.
This is a good question. If you find even one bug... Do you need to recheck?
Yes.
But when a bug is not a chazaka.
That's true. Whoever would like to know the details of that, that gets a little bit complicated in halacha in a sense. I could take about 5-10 minutes now and explain that, but I think
we'll take that question
a different time.
Okay, we'll take
the bottom line is that our policy requires that if you find even one insect in your whatever it is that you checked, everything, so to speak, fails.
We'll do that at the bug webinar too. Next month. Okay.
One last thing let's talk about here is blending or juicing, which we get probably hundreds of questions a week about, and that is the following, and that is that if you're dealing with conventional produce only, right, organic produce this does not work for, because organic produce, as I mentioned at the beginning, is considered muhsuk b'teilaim, and is, you have to check it no matter what. However, if you're dealing with conventional produce, the Rav Shlita, which is Rav Heinemann, Moshe Heinemann Shlita, he paskins that if your intention is not to be mevatel the insects, meaning you're blending it up, so in essence you're blending up whatever bugs might be in there, and you know you're going to become batel. They're not a barrier anymore, they're going to become completely batel. The question is, can you do that lechatchila? So Rav Heinemann holds that if your intention is not to avoid checking, meaning you're making a soup, a blended soup or a smoothie, or you're juicing, you know, very healthy now, the juice, or cilantro and spinach and things like that, kale. If you're doing it because you're juicing it anyway, you're making a smoothie anyway, it's allowed without even checking it. You could use any frozen strawberries you want to make the smoothie without having to check it. And again, this is only for conventional produce, does not apply to organic produce. Establishments under our Ashkacha do not do this, but for the home consumer, La Halacha, Rav Heinemann holds this is something that's mutter.
It's called Ein Mevatel, Ein Kavanas Levatel.
Ein Kavanas Levatel.
There is, did you have another slide?
No.
That's it? Okay, so we're going to take some questions now, but I have over here Rabbi Temler, I created this just for you. Let me show you this. There we go. We can. You can take a poll. We have a poll here of whether you check your own vegetables for insects. Usually, sometimes, never. So we can get an idea of how often people who are joining us are checking.
I mean, I would love to do this for other types of information. I mean, the more information and data we get on things, you know, the better. You know, as I mentioned before, you know, usually when people call us up and they say they found in a tomato, you know, it's not really information that we really can use or do anything with, because we don't know what kind of tomatoes, where they came from. So if people want to start filling out these types of forms and sending us, you know, real data if they find insects and something else, it'll be very helpful. Now, we have logs like this that all our mashgichim use in all our establishments, you know, to track, you know, the data, but obviously the more the better. So this is definitely something that is very useful, and we definitely appreciate everyone fills this in.
So let's take a look at some of the questions, Rabbi Tendler. If we took all of them, we'd be here for another few hours. I'm sorry, usually in our webinars we can get to all the questions, but here it's just really unbelievable. Okay, Nisana wants to know about onions. I know there were questions asked before, and I'm sorry we couldn't get to all of them, but again, if you have follow-up, please email us at info@star-k.org or give us a ring at 410-484-4110. Onions.
So onions, in at least in America, again, are not, the insects are not motzi and they do not have to be checked. Now, I'm not talking about scallions, green onions, right? I'm talking, you know, talking about vidalions, yellow onions, purple onions. They do not have to be checked. Okay. Someone here is asking about raspberries and blackberries, so I'll just mention briefly. They're very difficult to check. They could be checked. It's not something that it's recommended for a home consumer to do. If you want to get training in checking it, feel free to contact us and we'll discuss it. However, we do allow frozen raspberries, and that's a variety of reasons why the processing by frozen raspberries, which is very different than strawberries, we do allow IQF frozen raspberries to be used, but fresh definitely need to be checked, and there's no easy way really to, you know, to discuss or teach, you know, at least on a webinar, so to speak. You know, I know this is a great forum to discuss many items, but it's not really anything that we found. We could practically give over how to check raspberries. So we'll just leave it at that for.
Okay, about half of the people who are joining us have voted, from those, 40% usually check their own vegetables, and 10%. These numbers don't add up. It's 41% of everyone joining us today usually checks, 10% sometimes check, and 3% never check. So I guess it looks like most of the people who are with us usually will be checking their own vegetables.
Now, some people are saying different things that they say to have heard B'Shem Rav Hanina about different types of items. What we spoke about, the procedures here, are the policies of the Star K as directed by Rav Hanina. You know, obviously, everything we do in the Star K is Rav Hanina's policy, and you know, I think that clarifies, you know, any questions people have on that realm. This is what Rav Hanina holds has to be done.
Okay, Rabbi Tendler, we've been out for about an hour and a half. And I think people need a break because they can go check the vegetables. We thank everyone for joining us, and thank you for the production. It's a lot of work putting this together. Again, we want to thank Rabbi Zev Steen for the videos and some of the pictures. If you have any further questions, feel free to email us, info@star-k.org. Hopefully within a couple of days, we will be able to put up the video at kosherclasses.org and on our YouTube channel on Vimeo, so you can search it out over there. And the next webinar, our regularly scheduled, the last Wednesday of March. It's not Purim or Pesach, right?
No, it's pretty close. Uh-huh. It's in between.
Okay. Rabbi Heber once caught me on that. He said, we can't have it then. It's going to be Erev Sukkos, whatever it was. So, Thanks everyone for joining us. I know we had people from all over. We can actually see a little bit of where everybody is from. I know we have people from Eretz Yisrael, United States, obviously, West Coast, England, Canada, South America. So, thank you everyone for joining us, and have a very good day. All the best.
Thank you, everybody. Goldberg.